Welcome to the Awaken Ireland Show on TNS Radio.
You're very welcome to show 13 of Awaken Ireland Radio. I'm your host for the night, James O'Sullivan on tnsradio.com. And I just played a little bit of Fatalist there, I suppose, and just taking the mic a small bit in relation to the fact that, thank God, there was absolutely no false flag terrorist attack on the closing ceremony of the Olympics 2012. There's been an awful lot of information on the internet for many years now, including a young man called Rick Clay who's mysteriously died after a short illness, who was pointing out all of the occult similarities in relation to the build-up to the Olympics 2012 in London. And rest his soul. There's also, if you look at the ceremony itself, the opening ceremony, there's an awful lot of occult symbolism going on, which definitely raised an awful lot of heckles with people in the truth movement. And also in the closing ceremony, again, very, very similar dark clothing and dark ideology going on, a lot of it, really, to be honest with you. And I'm just very thankful, thank God, absolutely nothing happened, and that it finished without a hiccup. So we can move on from that particular conspiracy theory now, and hopefully let's see a few more positive things coming out of the troop movement in that sort of area over the coming months, and let's all focus on solutions, because this is what TNS Radio is all about. It's solutions based, and the upcoming show again is all about solutions and the build up to plenty of different movements in different areas. We have Tracey giving an update very shortly on what's happening nationwide within the Awaken Ireland area, and just all sorts of stuff been going on over the last while, and Tracey will give you a nice update on that very shortly. Also, we have Aisling on again this week because there was a fluoride conference that was on, and she has updates as well in relation to her own particular activism in relation to fluoride and the Thirst Games film that's being made to highlight the fluoride and the schools and around the country and around the world. And also we have Clare Leonard, who is very knowledgeable indeed about how money works and the Irish economy, international economy, and the difference between trading silver on the stock exchange and actual physical silver, as in a monetary system, which she says has been around for 6,000 years and has always increased in value over the long term. That's a great interview, and that'll be the last interview for the night. So we'll be here with you for the next hour and a half to 2 hours. And if anybody would like to ring in the show to briefly discuss all of the info that's been out there about the Olympics in relation to the troop movement and the occultism around it, you're more than welcome to ring in and have a brief chat. It's Cloud Warrior 1975. So before I play the first segment of the show, which is Tracey give us an update, I'm going to play another song and give anyone who wants to call in a chance to call in. If not, we go straight into the first segment of the show tonight. So again, you're very welcome to show 13 of Awaken Ireland Radio on tnsradio.com. This is David Gray Whiteladder. That was David Gray, and Whiteladder was the title of that particular song from his album Whiteladder. And we're going to go straight into the first segment of the show tonight. And this segment is lovely Tracey up in Dublin. Fair play to Tracey. She had to go to an internet cafe to record this because she didn't have the connection that she needed in her house. So thanks very much for doing that, Tracey. And here's an update from Tracey about the Awaken Ireland movement and what's happening all over the country and in different parts of the world, also in relation to what we're doing within the movement itself. So bear with me and I'll bring this up on screen. Here you go. There you go. Hello, Tracey. Tracey's going to give us an update there on what's going on around the country with Awaken Ireland. Tracey, we haven't had an update from you for quite a while now.
Yeah, hi, James. How are you?
Not too bad.
Good. Yeah, no, I haven't had an update for a while. Do you know, the good thing about the summer, James, is that there's so many gatherings and so many things happening that it's just everybody's out in the open and everybody's coming together. Since we spoke the last time, we got together, a few of us, up in New Grange Lodge for Awaken Ireland for an update meeting, a follow-on progress meeting from when we originally met in Bog Hill, so that we could discuss the structure and the principles of Awaken Ireland, where we're going, so we could put more of a concrete plan of action together. Talk about it. We talked about communications and our goals and the constitution and so on. Mm-hmm. It was a very, very productive meeting. And it was another chain in the link, I suppose, of making something concrete of what we're doing and putting something in place in terms of structure. We also had other people there, not just from Awaken Ireland, but from Direct Democracy, Ben Gilroy and John Squires, mm-hmm. and also John Wilson from Forum from Change in Donegal.
As that's right.
We all share a lot of the similar values, where we want to go. So they were delighted that they'd attended the meeting. We were delighted to have them as well, and there was an amazing synergy between us all. There was great synergy between everybody working together. Since then we have progressed from that Newgrange meeting, and we've had a separate meeting with Direct Democracy Ireland to discuss how we can work together.
There's and CPPC also.
Strong.
And
CPPC, sorry, James.
And CPPC also.
Yes, CPPC also, but yes. Individually with the Direct Democracy Ireland, and then we also then gathered with CPPC as well. Yeah, definitely, there's pieces of the jigsaw that are all coming together very strongly.
Mm-hmm.
And as I said, a great thing about the summer is that there's so many gatherings happening. So a number of us have been out interacting with people, telling them about Awaken Ireland, seeing what we can do to connect the dots with the different groups. There's a mm-hmm. really, really strong energy around people coming together at the moment. I feel that, and everybody I've spoken to feels that it's really strong too. We've also met with Second Republic, and again, they're doing a great job in coming together to try and see what they can do about changing the constitution as well. We've decided to come together physically in a night that we're putting on called Comedy and Conversations in Dublin on the 27th of September. Aidan Killian will be part of that. Obviously, he'll be gathering together the comedians, so it'll be a comedy night based on the satire of the current system that we're working in, as you may know mm-hmm. from Aidan's shows. We're also going to integrate then conversations into the night, so have an open space format conversations, mm-hmm. so people can get involved themselves in making a change.
Yeah.
So that's in conjunction with the Second Republic on the 27th of September in Dublin, but we'll keep you up to date about that. I was also there recently at the permaculture gathering, which Hannah Mole, who is also part of Awaken Ireland, hosted on her land in Roscommon. Now, permaculture, I didn't really know a lot about it, so I was delighted to go. And permaculture is basically common sense, but it hasn't. It's not so common anymore. It's mm-hmm. it's living together. It's everybody working together for the common good. Okay, so it's not just about agriculture.
Yeah.
It's not just about farming, sustainable living. It's about living together and how we work together. It's about turning what you think is waste into abundance.
Mm-hmm.
So there's the permaculture. There's permaculture courses going on all the time. Hannah is actually a lecturer, and she gives courses in permaculture. It was really amazing to get together with all these people who actually, you know, fit again very well with the ethos of Awaken Ireland and the structure that we're working against, that we're working through. So again, and lots of different contacts have been made through the permaculture gathering. Also, Clock Jordan. We've been talking to Davey Phillips and Clock Jordan as well. They're very strong with permaculture. Again, just linking everybody together and seeing how we can all work together. Just to let everybody know, there's if they don't know already, there's a gathering next weekend called Fail in the Pubble, which has been organised by the People's Association Watchdog. And it's basically a gathering to celebrate everything that everybody who's doing any sort of activism, so it's to celebrate what we're doing and mm-hmm. congratulate ourselves. It's been an event that's been put on for free. It's been run voluntarily. And again, it'll be another great opportunity to connect with people in different groups. There's lots of music, and there's it's a family event as well over the weekend. It's in Roscrea. And if anybody wants to have get more information on it, they just go to Feilenapobl. That's F-E-I-L-E-N-A-P-O-B-A-L. and they'll find it on Facebook. Again, they can email us, and we can send on more information as well. It's awakenireland@gmail.com.
Mm-hmm.
And we'll put up information on our Facebook page as well.
Great stuff.
Also, just on a last note, James, I managed to get down to the Awaken Ireland Open Forum in Cork there a couple of nights ago to experience exactly how those forums are run. And I was blown away. Clare Cullinan, who is very, very skilled in open space technology, which is a format of holding a meeting that encourages everybody to participate. It was really, really well done. And the amount of action plans and action projects that came out of that meeting were just astounding.
In a short period
of time, yeah. The next one that's in Cork.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. The next one that's in Cork is on Monday, the 3rd of September. Normally, they'll happen every second week. Just with the summer and things going on, it won't be for a couple of weeks. So the next one's the 3rd of September in Cork. I would encourage anybody in the area to actually go along and participate and have their say. From that, we're also going to be really starting up the open space technology meetings around the country. So watch this space. We'll definitely be hosting them soon.
Absolutely.
I think that's it for now, James. I can't think of anything else for the moment, but we'll keep you updated.
Well, that's fantastic. That's an awful lot of stuff happening, and I look forward to future updates from you, Tracey, in the near future. There's so much happening in relation to festivals and stuff. Yes, again, that festival again. Can you give us the date again for that festival that's coming up? That's the weekend after next, isn't it?
Yeah. It's next weekend.
This weekend coming.
It's Saturday and Sunday, the 18th and 19th of August, and it's in Roscrea, in a place called the Mill House. It's a free gathering, so you do have to go on to the Facebook page, and it's an invite only, so they need to know exactly who's coming. There's an email address on the Facebook page mm-hmm. that people can find out and register.
Brilliant. Okay, that's great, Tracey.
All right.
Okay, thank you.
Okay. Okay, thanks, James. Talk to you soon.
Okay, bye-bye.
Bye.
And that was Tracey O'Connor giving us an update on what's happening around the country within Awaken Ireland. There has been great success in recent times, as Tracey outlined, in relation to how groups of people who are brought together engage in conversations so that it doesn't end up being a talking shop or five or six of the biggest personalities in the room ending up being the only ones that get to speak, because as everyone knows who attends any sort of activist type meetings, it normally ends up being a talking shop where all you hear is the people with the biggest voices, which is not very productive. And what happens over time is that the people that might have something to say but might have a milder personality end up not coming back. So the open space technology is all about people put up on the board when they come in exactly what they want to talk about, and those you might have maybe 20 different topics, and they're all amalgamated then into four or five topics, because you'll find a lot of similarities in the 20 down into the you can amalgamate them down into the five, condense them down, and then you do a breakout session where you go off into a different space, or you stay at a round table and everyone goes to that space for that particular topic, and you have a discussion and someone takes notes, and you don't have anyone that's in charge, you just have a facilitator. And when the notes are taken, the person or somebody else nominated in the group might then talk exactly about what was talked about when it becomes their time to discuss it in front of the whole group. And then once those particular topics are covered, and their people are asked if they want to go off into a different group of particular interest, or if they want to continue on in the group they've already been part of, it's totally up to them. So the idea is complete and utter freedom of choice to move in and out of groups and to participate, and everyone should have an opportunity to participate. And if you don't wish to speak, you don't have to speak. And this is the basis of open space technology. And Clare Cullinan is excellent as facilitator for this, and she's blazing the way in facilitation. And we know very well in Awaken Ireland just how important facilitation is, because without facilitation, I don't think that the Bog Hill Centre in Clare, that meetup that we had back in March of this year, would have been as great a success as it was if it wasn't for and the facilitation skills of Chris Chapman, who is a professional facilitator and gave his time for free. And at that time we realised just how important it was to have a neutral facilitator in relation to any sort of brainstorming meetings, which is what's happening now on a regular basis every 2 weeks in Cork. And the next one is on the 6th of September, as far as I'm aware, again in Cork, in the Imperial Hotel in Cork. And we're going to be setting up one in Dublin very shortly, and you will know all about that because it will be plastered all over Facebook and the posters will go up as well. And we're going to do the exact same thing up there, and we'll have a facilitator that will pretty much replicate the way that it's organised in Cork. And we hope to have these meetings happening all over the country very, very shortly. And to give you an idea how successful this sort of facilitation is, we had multiple new political parties that were there, and political convention parties that were there. And normally when you bring all these different groups into one space, that ends up being a bit of a muck-flinging match to a degree, where people are trying to score points. And that never happened once, I can safely say, in the 4 hours that we were there, from 7:30 till 11:30, which is pretty incredible, really. So that's that. That's the open space technology. And now move on to the next segment. But before we do, we'll go to another quick song. And this one is Crowded House, and it's called Fall at Your Feet. Okay, up next we have Aisling Aisling of the Flouride Campaign. And last week we discussed briefly the fact that Aisling got her kit off to help promote the Flouride Campaign and appeared in front of different airports around the country in a bare knickers and a t-shirt. Okay, this might get your attention in the chat boxes. So here's Aisling talking about getting her kit off, the reasons why she did it, also the Turf Games, a film that they're developing in relation to the Flouride, and also the Flouride meetup that they had up in Mullingar over the last week, which is very promising. That was a north-south border coming together for the eradication of fluoride in the south, and to make sure it stays out of the north where they're trying to get it back in again. So here is Aisling again. And on Skype we have Aisling Fitzgibbon. Aisling, how are you?
I'm very good, how are you?
Not too bad. We have you on the show again. We had you on the show last week, but because you're so busy with your activism that we said we'd get you back on the show again this week. To give us a quick update about the conference that you had up the country in the Midlands there, and also your own individual stunts that you've been pulling yourself.
Okay. We had a very good meeting up in Mullingar. It was on the 4th of August, and so 25 people showed up altogether from all around the country. We also had people come down from the north of Ireland. So as a result, now we've set up a group called the Cross Border Pure Water Alliance.
Okay.
So we're going to be merging the campaigns in the north to stop them from reintroducing fluoride, and also then bring it down to the south to actually eliminate it fully from the country.
Mm-hmm.
So it was a very good meeting. We've had we set up into different kind of subgroups. I'm in the PR group, and we also have a guy who actually runs his own PR company who's agreed to work with us, so that we'll have proper strategy now for the campaign.
Okay.
And so that's really positive, you know, and a lot of people are much more committed, I think, after having that meeting. We really feel like we need to channel our energy now all together, even though we're dispersed in different counties, that everything that we're doing is all tying in to the overall campaign. So it's not just, you know, things being done in isolation.
That's very important, because you're not going to be duplicating methods or ideas or activism, whatever, you know.
Yeah, and exactly, and to have the same kind of approaches in, like, the same kind of poster format, the same information being handed out, make sure that we're singing from the same hymn sheet, so that we're there's a sense of unity in our working. So then before we had the meeting, we actually had another meeting with this guy who's making the film for Turf Games. So we've got the script now, that's all been written and ready.
Okay, do you want to give people a little bit of a taste of what that's all about?
Yeah, so the Turf Games, the idea is we're doing a mini movie. It's based upon the characters coming from the Hunger Games, and they're coming to Ireland, and they're being briefed on their mission, which is basically to get the fluoride out of Ireland. So they're being educated about it, and then they are appealing then to the Irish children to help them on their mission to get the flouride out of Ireland. So that's going to be sent out to 200 schools in September, which will be the transition year students across the country. And with the competition is based on raising public awareness about the dangers of fluoride, and there'll be different prizes and prizes for the kids, for the teacher, and for the school who win. So really, it's going to be a really good opportunity for us to get out to kids who we can't reach, you know, as we can't travel to every county. Mm-hmm. Just the idea to have a competition, it would be more of an incentive for them to learn about it, and again, for them to be doing all the work in their own community and raising the awareness, which is kind of the key part of this campaign, is public perception of fluoride.
Absolutely.
And changing the common opinion that fluoride is good for the teeth. So that's going to be all go in September now, going out with the big packs, going out to all the schools. And so we're looking forward to that. We've already gotten contact from different teachers and things around the country who are looking to introduce in the thirst game to their schools. So I'm sure we'll have no problem getting the numbers anyway. And if it's successful, we're going to run it for an 8-week period firstly, and then if it is really good and it works really well, we're going to do another 8 weeks then after Christmas.
Mm-hmm. Right.
So who knows, it has the potential to take off, so we just have to put it into action and see what happens.
Yeah, fantastic. Come here, tell me, you've been revealing a bit of flesh around the country, I hear. Is that right?
Oh, yeah.
At airports.
Yeah, that's right.
And the Spire and all sorts of places.
Yeah.
How did you get the idea to do that?
That came from my mother's idea, really. Mm-hmm. Who's obviously pushing her daughter to behave outrageously. So we printed off this black knickers with the get the F out symbol. And then we had the t-shirt on off. Oh, my mum, I don't know how we ended up thinking about it. We'd never go to Clare Airport anyway, and let the people know that are coming in off the flight that the Irish water is actually toxic industrial waste. So we did up posters, put them into the toilets, and we gave them out then to passengers that were coming in off the flight. And, I whipped off my coat anyway, so I was standing there in a t-shirt and just my black sneakers and high heels. And I did a nice photograph with a few guys from they were on their way to Cork, so I'm sure they had a good laugh pointing at my bum for posing for the pictures. So it was good fun. So we were heading to Dublin, so we said, sure, we may as well do something up there as well. So we did the pictures then outside the Spire and the GPO, and just gave out some leaflets, again the same that we were giving out in Kerry. And then we headed out to Dublin Airport and to the arrivals section, so we gave out some leaflets there as well. I posed with a nice man. Where was he coming from? I think it was France.
Was he?
Yeah, we were telling him, he shouldn't be here.
He shouldn't be here.
The Irish water is dangerous and things. Yeah.
What did he say to that?
We gave him the information. I'd say he was a bit shell shocked, to be honest, seeing as I was actually only wearing knickers, which is quite unusual.
It normally would be at
that
time, yeah?
We have loads more stunts up our sleeve now, which will be a bit way more in your face, and hopefully we're going to get into the actual mainstream media, so we're going to plan it properly now. They were just test ones to gauge people's reaction. The main thing was actually the reaction that I got on Facebook. I got massive support from people that never knew about Florida, contacted me, and people have been sharing the pictures, and it just grabbed people's attention. Because I think people are used to seeing posts of just text. I think the visual imagery just really kind of is a bit more striking than the average post. So I'm really delighted. I got a massive amount of people wanting to support and wanting to post to their areas and how can they help the campaign. So we have gotten, it has really upped the levels of supporters for the campaign. So I think it was positive anyway to do it. So I think it's going to give me a taste for, wow, okay, that was really nothing, no effort required to do that. So we kind of need to go a bit more and push out the boundaries a bit more and do some more fun, kind of eye-catching events.
I
don't want to give anything away, but we'll be putting them up soon. And fingers crossed we'll get into some paper, even if the Sun or the Mail or any of them, if they picked it up, it would be absolutely amazing.
No, keep doing what you're doing, Ashton. We're very proud of you. Fair play to you. Give us the website there again where you can donate money to Ashton's cause.
Oh, yeah. The website is www.sue.gov.fluoride.com. And if you want to contact me, then I'm on Facebook. It's Ashling-Fitzgibbon. So it's Ashling-Fitzgibbon. I'm also working on a new website now in the next 2 weeks, and that's going to be www.thegirlagainstfluoride.com. That's not up and running yet, but it will be in the next 2 weeks.
Very good.
And that's going to have a personal video blog from me and a story about the campaign, and it's going to be much more human and really fun approach to kind of educate people about fluoride, and again to get more support for the campaign. People's skills and resources that we're looking for make this nationwide campaign a complete success, and to hit the tipping point and get everyone aware of what's happening in our water supply.
Fantastic.
So I think it's all moving in a very positive direction now, and I think up to Christmas now, I think it's going to just gain full momentum, and people are really just outraged when they find out. And I just think, you know, we have in our favour, we have creativity and we have positivity and just, you know, brilliant energy about us, and I think that will bring about the change. And I think, you know, once the fluoride, once that comes out, you know, that will be the catalyst then for people to wake up to everything else.
Yeah.
You know.
Wonderful. Thanks very much, Ashton. Yeah. We're going to leave it at that, and mm-hmm. we'll get you on again in the near future when you have more updates for us. And best of luck with your public stunts and activism in the future.
Oh yeah, thanks very much.
Ashton Fitzgibbon there again this week. Thanks very much, Ashton, for coming on again. You were on last week, and I know it's asking a lot to come back on again this week. But there's so much happening in relation to the fluoride campaign that we had to get her back on again to give us a quick update. So we're going to go to another quick song, and after that then we've got our final segment of the night, which is a fantastic interview with Clare Leonard of Occupy Dame Street fame, and also in relation to money systems and the economy. And this is a very, very, very good interview indeed. So here's Evanescence, Sweet Sacrifice. Those songs always finish so quickly. It was catch on unawares. Evanescence there, Sweet Sacrifice, amazing band, love listening to them. One of the heavier bands that I listen to normally, more into easy listening stuff, but yeah, I really, really dig their music. It's kind of gothic rock, and there's some really, really, really lovely stuff in there with Evanescence. Check them out. I don't know if any of you are watching the closing ceremony, but they had Muse that were playing live there on the stage, and it's funny to see them playing something like that, because they are totally anti-establishment and very much a truth-seeking band. If you listen to any of their lyrics, they're very much into putting in little gems of the truth about what's really going on in the world in their songs. So surprised to see them there, but sure, look, they're all under control of the music industry globally, and probably didn't have much choice but to perform and probably enjoyed it as well. So to finish off the show tonight, we have the last segment with Clare Leonard from Occupy Dame Street. I've had the pleasure of meeting Clare many times now, and looking forward to hearing this in particular interview, as when you're actually doing an interview, it's very hard to get the overall gist of it. So I can sit back and relax and chill out and have a listen to this, and fair pay to you, Clare, for coming on earlier on today to record this, because it's probably past your bedtime, to be honest with you, to be sitting back and recording this at this hour tonight. So thanks again, Clare. And here is the Clare Leonard interview in relation to money reform and the money system globally. And on Skype we had the lovely Clare Leonard. Clare is a wonderful person. I've met her many times, and Clare was the treasurer for the Occupy Dame Street camp. Is that right, Clare?
Yes, that's correct. Yeah.
And Clare is also very interested in many other topics and has a good understanding of the economy and money, and we'll be talking about a lot of different topics in relation to that. So you're very welcome to Awaken Ireland Radio Show on TNS Radio, Clare. So Clare, so tell us a little bit about you, because I always like to make these interviews personal. How did you get interested in activism?
Well, I was always very, even when I was very young, I was always very politically aware. In the 60s, we picketed Lansdowne Road for the South African rugby team, way back before anyone even knew what apartheid meant.
Right.
And in fact, we there was only about six of us, and we put a picket outside the hotel, which was the Hibernian Hotel at the time there. It's gone now. And the South African rugby team came to the window and pelted us with apples and tomatoes and anything they could get their hands on. And everyone thought it was hilarious. But that was my first outing in campaigning. And then I spent 20 years overseas, so that kind of put a bit of manners on me for a while.
Very good, very good.
So from there then, obviously you developed some more of an interest in it. And where did you go from there?
I became interested at as I travelled around overseas. I became very aware that the international monetary system was causing absolute havoc throughout the world and was responsible for the death of thousands and hundreds of thousands of children and adults.
Yeah.
And I became obsessed in trying to understand how the system worked.
Yeah.
I studied it for quite a while, and when Occupy Dame Street came to my attention, I thought, oh my goodness, people are beginning to wake up to the damage that the financial system is doing to the world. This is fantastic.
Yeah.
And it's global, which was, to me, wonderful, because this has to be tackled on a global level in order to try to defeat the evil, because it is pure evil.
Sure.
And I became interested because of that. That's the reason, because I saw it as a global movement that might bring about change, you know, and Wall Street was particularly important because I knew the core of the beast, the heart of the beast, was in Wall Street.
Okay.
So that's why I became involved in Occupy Dame Street. But now I'm that Occupy Dame Street is gone, I'm involved with Direct Democracy, and I'm their financial spokesperson for the moment.
Okay, so before we move on to the money system or the political area, can I ask you a little bit about your experiences with Occupy Dame Street, how you got there, how you ended up being the treasurer? Just give us a little story on that.
Occupy Dame Street, I have gone through very, very difficult times in my life, because I've had a very diverse background and living conditions and everything. But I did find Occupy Dame Street probably one of the hardest things I've ever done in my life, because it was an open door to everyone. And it was in the middle of a city and in the middle of an area in the city which had a very serious social problems.
Yeah.
And you had to deal with those social problems every day.
Mm-hmm.
And I learned actually quite a lot from it. And I think I walked away a better person than I went in.
Okay.
But I must admit, I did find it very, very hard going.
Mm-hmm. Okay. And what sort of people did you meet along the way?
Oh, everybody under the sun. Everybody under the sun, from anarchists to fascists to capitalists to socialists. And the one thing everybody had in common was they knew the system had to change, that it was unjust. And basically I would say I'm a capitalist, with the small c. But I don't believe capitalism can work unless you have social justice.
Okay.
And everybody there, didn't make any difference what their background was, we worked together because we all wanted social justice.
Okay, so when you say you're a capitalist, can you go into a bit more detail of what that actually means to you?
What does that mean to me?
Yeah.
It's not so much that I'm a diehard capitalist, but from my life experience, I believe that it's probably not fantastic, but it's probably the best deal that's on the table. For instance, when I see the left now on programs like Vincent Brown and so forth, and the policies that they're putting forward, while I agree with what they're trying to achieve, I believe they're only making their policy solutions are only making the situation worse.
Okay.
And the reason for that is that I fully understand where they're coming from. and I would agree with what they're trying to achieve, but I can't believe they're going about it the wrong way.
Mm-hmm.
Because since 19, in the 70s, you've had a 57% collapse in the standard of living. Now, the reason you've had that huge collapse in the standard of living, in the 70s, it took one person to maintain a family, one person working to maintain a family.
Mm-hmm.
Today, it takes two people, and even with two people working, they're still 10 to 15% poorer than they were in the 70s. But there's a reason for that, and the reason for it is the printing of paper money.
Okay.
And the more paper money they print, they reduce the purchasing power of that money. For instance, the euro in the last 12 months, probably 6 months, the purchasing power has dropped by about 15%.
Mm-hmm.
Now, a kitchen porter in the year 2000 got about €8 an hour. They're still getting €8 an hour. So if you take inflation into consideration, their wages have actually nearly halved.
Mm.
So I understand where the left is coming from, but the solutions that they're offering is actually only making the situation worse.
And what solutions are they offering?
They're offering to bond buying and borrowing money to prime the economy and so forth.
Mm-hmm.
But the minute you go into printing of money, it's taxation through the back door. It's taxation while you're asleep and nobody sees it, because mm-hmm. it's as I said, the purchasing power of the euro has dropped 15% because they're printing it.
Mm-hmm.
So much of it, if you go into the petrol station and everything now, well, it's a combination of printing of euros and also the dollar, because the dollar is used for internationally for purchasing oil and wheat and so forth.
Mm-hmm.
But that's why people die of starvation in the world, because we're interconnected with the dollar. You can't disconnect your analysis of the solution without taking into consideration the dollar, because it's really, it's an imperial currency.
Mm-hmm.
But it affects our lives, because the more they print to conduct wars and so forth, the more we have to spend to buy oil and buy wheat.
Mm-hmm.
Now, whatever hope we have as a society in Ireland of absorbing that level of inflation caused by the printing of paper money, when you're in the third world or a developing country, it could be the difference between starving and not starving.
Right.
And that's what, you know, and that's what brought me to the table of this. Unless we can bring in a monetary system that is an honest, solid monetary system that can't be mass-produced by politicians and corrupt bankers, we're doomed as a people
mm-hmm.
throughout the world, you know?
Well, they're not going to stop doing what they do, are they?
Pardon?
They're not going to stop doing what they do. It's like it's a monster out of control.
It's a monster out of control, but I do believe that if people understood how they can defeat them, that it is, they are quite defeatable.
Mm-hmm.
They are defeatable. I know what their weak points is, and I think if most people are beginning to wake up around the world, you know, large parts of the world now are no longer using the dollar to trade internationally.
Okay.
You have Japan has made agreements with China. China has made agreements with India. India has made agreements with Iran. Brazil, also Australia recently, quite amazing.
You serious?
Has made an agreement to bypass the dollar as the global reserve currency.
I didn't know Australia would do that. They're very much tied in with the Western allies, you know.
That's amazing that they stepped aside from using the dollar as a trading currency. It's astonishing. It's a huge change in the world. We're literally going through a third world war right now, except it's taking place in Wall Street and the other major financial centers in the world.
Yeah.
And there are huge changes coming about over the next 6 to 12 months, certainly 18 to 12 months to 2 years. You're going to see massive changes, changes. And a lot of them won't be for the good, unfortunately.
What do you see coming?
I see actually the collapse of the dollar. I see the collapse of the dollar, but unfortunately, 80% of all dollars printed are outside the United States. And when countries stop trading in the dollar, those dollars have to go somewhere. If they go back to the States, there's two ways they can go back. They can go back buying up assets in the United States, or they can go back as enormous flood of currency. And basically what you're looking at is very similar to Weimar Germany or Zimbabwe. It's that serious. It really is that serious.
When you're trading with cigarettes.
Pardon?
When you end up trading with cigarettes instead of money.
Well, there you go. You know, they expanded their influence throughout the world since the 70s, since they disconnected from the gold standard in the 70s. They have expanded their influence throughout the world on a paper system that everyone was obliged to use. And that gave it credibility, but it's no longer working. But the consequences of that have yet to be seen.
Is it true that the American dollar is only worth a couple of cents? If you disconnect the dollar from the international markets, it's actually only worth a couple of cents. It's because it's tied to the petrodollar, isn't that correct?
Well, the purchasing power of the dollar in the last 4 years alone has dropped over 40%.
Yeah.
40%. Mm-hmm. Now, you might think, well, that's to do with the United States. But it doesn't. Because you can go into, say, Tanzania, a very, very poor country, and they have to buy fuel, and they have to use dollars to buy that fuel. So it means they're paying 40% more to purchase fuel. And that has to come out of money that could have gone to education, could have gone to medical system, could have gone to feeding people.
Yeah.
It's an appalling abuse of humanity.
Mm-hmm.
And that money has been devalued because they're printing it to conduct wars.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. You know, and the American people are going to suffer probably far more than anyone else in the next. They've maintained a very good standard of living because mm-hmm. they were able to print money without any concern for their own citizens up to now. But I dread to think of what's going to happen, quite frankly.
Well, the middle class are just—they're starting to panic now because the unemployment is going through the roof over in the United States now. The middle class is starting to shrink, and the poor are getting even more poor, you know. And the Occupy movement, I think, has started in a broad sense because of the lack of prosperity and the lack of a future for the, you know, the majority of the students coming out of the colleges and universities in the United States were nowhere to go.
Well, the middle classes throughout the Western world are being wiped out.
Yeah.
Because they were traditionally the savers.
Yeah.
And the savers have nothing to show for all their years of saving. They're being wiped out. But what's interesting about what's happening to the middle classes today is if you look at a graph of the money in the hands of people in 1929, it's almost identical to today. Mm-hmm. You had 90, I'm generalizing here, but anyway, you had 99% of the money in the hands of 1%.
Yeah.
And if you look at a graph of where the money is today, you'd swear you were looking at 1929.
Okay.
And capitalism can't function when you don't have a reasonable distribution of wealth. It's right. Just not possible. You get a collapse.
Can you explain that in a little bit more detail, Claire? Why that doesn't work?
Well, $17 trillion has been pumped into the banking system over the last few years to try to stop the collapse that's inevitable, right?
Mm-hmm.
But that $17 trillion has gone into the banking system. It hasn't gone into the general economy. And if you literally look at where the money is and the percentage of people... I'm talking about big money now. I'm talking about capital that could reignite an economy. I'm not talking about smaller stuff.
Yeah.
But if you look at a graph of 1929, most of the money was in the hands of 1%. Today, it's exactly the same.
And how did they manage to reverse that trend, Claire? How did they manage to get the money out of the 1% into the middle classes more?
Because they're printing, it's a debt-based creation of money. And the first people who benefit from the printing press on the creation of money, the printing of it. It's like a manufacturing system. Mm-hmm. The central banks have the monopoly on manufacturing paper money. They could just as easily have a monopoly on manufacturing T-shirts. They have a monopoly on, they have a monopoly on manufacturing currency, yeah, which we're obliged to use. It's a Ponzi scheme.
Mm-hmm.
But the people at the top benefit most from the Ponzi scheme.
Yeah. So, yeah, it's, I mean, it goes back to 1912, doesn't it? The was it Christmas Eve 1912 when they passed the Federal Reserve Act?
That's correct, yeah. Yes. But our central bank, people seem to think that the Irish central bank belongs to the Irish people.
Who does it belong to?
They answer to the ECB. They're not answerable to us. So when Patrick Houlihan went in the night of the big bailout and he went on national radio and he pulled the rug from under... what was the Minister of Finance's name at
Brian
the time?
Lenehan.
I can't remember. Sorry?
Brian Lenehan.
Yes. When he pulled the rug from under his feet, I don't know this for a fact, but I suspect he was acting on the instructions of the ECB.
And the Bilderberg Group, apparently.
Yeah. Well, they have a monopoly on the manufacture of money. They're not going to give it up too easily. You know,
yeah,
the citizens have to take honest money back into their own hands and get out of the system
as it currently is designed.
It'll impoverish everybody.
Can I ask you from your own studies, Clare, what would be your solution to this? Because see, it's such a monster of a system. It's a debt-based money system that, you know, it's all centralized at the very, very top of the pyramid. So where do you even start to try and turn this around?
I think myself it's quite, I know this sounds simplistic, but I think it's actually quite easy to turn around. But I think we should work with the Spaniards and the Italians, because what's happening right now is we're being isolated and then we're being picked off one after the other. The solution is that you create a monetary system that is outside the control of politicians, because they've proved they can't be trusted, and the central bank system. And that's very easy to do, because you go back to a sound and honest monetary system, which is based on a commodity that can't be mass produced. It's not that I have a huge love for gold and silver, but it's a product that has been money for 6,000 years, and you can't mass produce it.
Now, just to be devil's advocate there, Clare, right, that some people know that, well, not a lot of people actually know, but some people know that the Goldman Sachs are the ones who set the gold price twice daily in the city of London, right?
Yes.
They have a monopoly on gold, and they have a monopoly on silver. Now, if these people have a monopoly, how can you trust it then?
Yeah, well, let me explain.
Okay.
The banking system manipulate and control the quoted on the stock exchange price of gold and silver, because they're not, it's a Ponzi scheme similar to paper money. For every 1 ounce of silver that they have in their vaults, they sell over 100 pieces of paper. So a lot of people who think they've gold and silver actually only have a promissory note on a piece of paper. Now, they manipulate that, and JP Morgan is the biggest manipulator of it, and they manipulate it to maintain the value of the dollar.
Right.
The reason they do that is because if gold and silver went up too high, people would run from the dollar. So the manipulation that goes on in the market is to protect the dollar. Right.
Okay.
But there's a completely different market in physical gold and physical silver. Now, central banks and China, all the central banks, and especially China and Russia, everyone knows the paper system now is collapsing. All the big guys on the top know it's collapsing. It's like they're on the deck of the Titanic and they're running around like lunatics, buying as much physical gold and silver as they can get their hands on, not paper. So when you're looking at the price that's being manipulated on the stock market, it's not real market. But central banks know the difference. They're collecting physical, and China is collecting physical. The paper Ponzi scheme will collapse because it's a pyramid system. It will collapse. It's only a matter of time. It could be 1 week, could be 2 weeks, could be 3 weeks. So there's a two markets. There's the physical market and there's the paper Wall Street market. You understand?
Yes, I do. So basically what you're saying is that the stock market, silver and gold trading is just, it's a fiction, just like the money system, the paper money system, the dollar system, the sterling system that's out there as well, which is a fiction also, okay? And that's just based on confidence, okay? And so it's all based on the market's ability to sell and to buy. So if they all stop doing that tomorrow, then it will collapse. So that you're saying the same thing would happen with the paper version of the gold and silver. Is that right?
Yes. It's a fractional reserve. You know, when you put 100 euros into the bank, they take that 100 euros and they will take 9 euros of it and they will lend it out over and over and over and over again. So it's a multiple of that 100 euros that they could lend out 1,000 to 1. In the banking system, it's a pyramid system. The paper lending, borrowing, is a pyramid system. So too is the paper gold and silver market. It's a pyramid system. It's completely different from the physical.
Okay.
Do you understand?
People
at the very top, they know the difference because they perpetuate the pyramid system. Do
okay.
you understand?
Here's another question for you, Clare, right? If the powers that be, okay, if they're buying all the gold globally, they know this, the Titanic is sinking, okay, a time will come very shortly where it'll be unaffordable to buy gold and silver to protect a currency like the euro?
Yeah, absolutely. You won't be able to buy it because it's not available. You actually won't be able to get it.
Okay.
You actually won't be able to get it. Because while I believe that the powers that be know a collapse is coming, they're all positioning themselves for that collapse. Now, what I want to do is warn the average citizen of what is happening. So, because no one is protecting them.
Yeah.
The only government protecting their citizens over the last 12 months to 2 years are, funnily enough, the Chinese.
They're
protecting their citizens, and it's quite amazing, isn't it?
Yes.
No other country in the world is protecting their citizens, but the Chinese are. Well, mind you, there's a vested interest in it. They have told their citizens to get rid of their paper and buy gold and silver physical coins. And they have gold and silver shops on every corner, like we have pubs.
Yeah.
But I, in the beginning of 2010, I sent in a policy document to the government on the introduction of a parallel system of gold and silver in order to protect people's pensions and their savings and so forth. And it was rejected on the basis that it could undermine the financial system. Well, lo and behold, you know, who has faith in the financial system? But I won't go into that just now.
Okay. Yeah, I'm surprised that they didn't even entertain us at all for the moment. We'll follow on to that shortly. So go on anyway.
What I'd like to do now is to try to help people to understand what's happening and that they're part. You see, people are waiting for this disastrous collapse, but in fact it's happening. Drip, 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 drip.
Yeah.
For instance, like the purchasing power of your money you've got in your pocket. If somebody's on a minimum wage of 8 euros, and let's say 10 euros because it's easier to calculate.
Yeah.
Let's say if somebody's working at 10 euros an hour, in the last 6 months, that 10 euros is worth 8.50.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And at the rate we're going, it'll be worth, in purchasing power, 6. So we're getting poorer and poorer by the day.
Mm-hmm.
And somebody needs to tell the people what's happening, because the politicians, they either don't understand, or they're too scared, or they don't care. I don't know. I read an article today in the newspaper. I couldn't believe what I was reading. And I wrote it down. I won't mention the name.
Okay.
But a senior civil servant from the Department of the Taoiseach and the Department of Finance just retired. And I'm going to quote you what he said.
What?
Financial and economic risks are not fully understood by politicians. And he has just retired with a lump sum of 570,000 euros and 142,000 a year pension. And he has the gall to say that the financial and economic risks are not fully understood by politicians. What, my question is, what was he doing? What was he doing as a senior member of staff? Why didn't he enlighten these politicians? And yet they're turn around and they pay him 570,000 as a lump sum and 142,000 a year. You couldn't make this stuff up.
I know. But and the truth of it is, Clare, that it's the senior politicians, or sorry, the senior civil servants are the ones that run the country, because politicians, they come and they go. And they reshuffle the ministerial positions all the time as well. It's like a game of chess, right? So the only thing that's stable in government is the civil servants, because they're there for life. So they're the actual people who run the government.
Yes, they run the government and they're incompetent. Personally, I'd have that person arrested.
Yeah.
Because the consequences for the average person are just too appalling to even start talking about.
Okay. Can we go through two scenarios here, Clare, right? Now, just, I'm asking you to do this, and I'm asking you to be very dualistic with this, okay? I don't want to scare people, but we have to do both sides of the coin here. Let's look at the scenario of the collapse of the euro tomorrow and what will happen in the country, in your understanding, and then offer an alternative solution to that happening over time, what we can do. Can you do that?
What I'd like to see happening in Ireland, and in fact, I've been on to the Spanish embassy, because what I'd really love is if we could work together with Spain and Italy, because... Yeah. They're being wiser than us. They haven't asked for a bailout.
Okay.
Because I read somewhere during the week, they have to destroy them before they can save them. Well, that's what they did with us.
Yeah.
They destroyed us to, in inverted commas, save us. Well, that just means to get us within their claws of control.
Oh, the sovereignty gone.
The Spanish have learned from our mistake. They're not going to ask for a bailout. If they're wise, they won't ask for a bailout, because all this is about is to grab, I'm not going to go into it because it's a bit too complex, but I believe that if we can work with the Spanish and work with the Italians, we can implement a system that will protect our citizens and actually put the countries back on the road to prosperity.
Yeah.
And that is a parallel currency of gold and silver.
Okay. Now I have to ask you this question, right? How does this country purchase enough silver or gold to be able to implement it into the economy for the people? Where do we get the money from to do that?
Where would we get it?
Yeah.
Well, basically, my idea is that you would press the coins with no face value on them. You wouldn't put 5 euros or 10 euros value on them. Mm-hmm. They would be sold on weight.
Mm-hmm.
And because they're sold on weight, let's say you had a quarter ounce silver coin, and let's say it cost you 5 euros, right? Mm-hmm. That silver coin in your pocket, because silver will go up, and as long as they keep printing paper money, that silver coin in your pocket, the purchasing power will go up all the time. Even if they continue to manipulate it in the market, it will still go up in price.
Mm-hmm.
So the money that you have, if you go in with 100 euros and you transfer it and you take silver coins in your pocket instead, those silver coins in your pocket are going up in purchasing power. They're going up in value in purchasing power in your pocket, whereas the paper money is dropping. The purchasing power of the paper money is dropping all the time. So basically, you're not threatening anyone. You keep the euro, but good money will actually push out bad money eventually. But it's a free market in money, and I don't know what they're afraid of. Like, if the euro is so great, why are we being forced to use that and only that? And if it's not so good, my question is, why are we using it? But in introducing a parallel currency, it's a free market and people can decide themselves.
Okay. Now that I like where you're coming from with this. Now, just to finish off this point, right? The are you suggesting that the government sets up some sort of mint, right?
and produces coins and has like a some place you can go, like a shop or something, like a national shop.
Yeah, a post office. The paper I put into the government was that they would be so bought and sold through the post office.
Bought and sold. So you say, for example, if you get your social welfare tomorrow or you get your paycheck, and you go into the post office and you exchange like for like, you get €100 worth of coins in silver, which don't have a denomination on them, and then you can use them to purchase goods and then in Tesco or Super Value or wherever you go.
Yes, and the price of that coin would be set on the spot value. For instance, I'm just looking here. I have, you see, the value of it would never go down, right? Because they never, I'm looking for, I have a chart on the increase in the price of silver here over various different currencies, United States, Australia, Canada, China, Europe, Japan, Great Britain, Switzerland. In the last 10 years, on average, the value of those coins have gone up 24% in all of those currencies. And it's a globally recognized as money, okay?
Yeah.
That has been for thousands of years. Yeah. So that means, for instance, if in 2001 somebody bought a silver coin, that silver coin, because there's no face value on it, it's just the weight, would now be worth 24% more.
Mm-hmm.
Now, if people had a dollar in their pocket, they've lost 50% of the purchasing power. Okay. So there's a 75% difference. You're up 24% on your silver. You're down 50% on your dollar. Do you understand?
I do understand that. Now, here's another practical point for you, okay?
Yes.
How do the shops deal with that? If you walk in with a five euro worth of a silver coin, or just a silver coin worth a certain weight then, right? And they're going to have to, every time you make a purchase, they're going to have to check what the value is in the stock market, aren't they?
No, it would be set for a month, maybe 3 months at a time, it would be set at a particular value. And then as the spot price goes up, it would be reset.
By a national office.
It would be very easy to do. People would get very used to it. Throughout the Middle East and most parts of the world, they still trade a lot in silver and in gold.
That's the gold dinar, isn't it?
Yeah, they just weigh it and say that's what it's worth. You know, it's they do it in most parts of the world. In Vietnam, most 25% or 30% of all houses are quoted in gold.
Okay.
It's just we've lost the we. You see, up to 1971, in 1944, there was an international UN conference
mm-hmm.
where the dollar was made the global reserve currency.
That was the Bretton Woods, isn't it?
And that was backed by gold.
Was that Bretton Woods?
Bretton Woods, exactly. Yeah. But all currencies were tied to that, which meant that they all had to observe the same... they couldn't mass produce their currencies, right? But in Vietnam, when Vietnam occurred, Nixon needed to huge amounts of money to conduct that war. And he couldn't keep printing dollars because he had to set aside the gold before he could print the money.
Yeah.
And he disconnected from it so that he could conduct the war.
That was called the Nixon shock.
And then they mass produced, and that's what has us in the position we're in today. And that's why I say, if you have a solid, honest monetary system that's backed by a solid gold or silver, which is recognized throughout the world as money, politicians can't do that. It would also control wars, because people couldn't conduct wars if they couldn't print money. Who's going to pay for them?
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah, it sounds very plausible to me. Now, another question is, then for the smaller denominations of money, right, for the euros and for the 50 cent and the 30 cent, does that stay as coinage as it is, or what?
I'm sorry, James, the line's a bit bad, so I'm sorry, could you repeat that?
For the smaller denominations of currency, right, the euro, 50 cent, 30 cent, 20 cent, whatever, how does that work?
Well, the euro would stay exactly as it is now, exactly as it is now. It would function exactly as it is now. And in many ways, you would need to do that because we have so many multinational companies. would disrupt the economy too much by changing it. But what the having a parallel system does is it protects our citizens. You know, if anyone wants to trade in the euro, let them fire ahead. That's their business, you know.
Yeah.
I believe free choice. But once people understand that if they had silver in their pocket for the last 10 years, they're 25% richer. If they had a dollar or a euro in their pocket, they're an awful lot poorer in terms of purchasing power. You see, it's all about purchasing power.
Mm-hmm.
People will very quickly cop on which is good money, which is bad money. You know, I find people are Irish people are very smart.
Mm-hmm.
You know, the Spanish, I'd like to get them on board. I'd like to get the Italians on board because they've got a more historic understanding of the value of a solid currency.
Sure.
Because of their history, you know.
Okay.
But years ago, my mum gave me, when she would give me a present, she'd give me a silver coin or something like that. Unfortunately, I was my house was robbed, and a few coins I got from my mother are gone. But my parents' generation understood that silver was money.
Sure.
Silver is the poor man's gold.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
And you would trade houses and larger commodities like that, maybe in gold. But silver would be the everyday poor man's gold, you know?
Okay. Right now, can you just go and buy silver and exchange it then for euros? Say, for example, if tomorrow you get your paycheck, right, and you've got 500, 600 euros or whatever, right? Can you go and exchange that for silver someplace and then put your silver into a bank or put your silver into a security box in your home someplace and then convert it as you need it? Can you do that?
Yeah, well, I'll tell you what, it's interesting because in Indonesia, the civil servants are paid, I think it's half their wages or 30% of their wages are paid in silver coins.
Okay.
Silver and gold coins, depending on your earning ability. The only people who are minting coins right now are the central banks. Our central bank mint them, but they're charging four times over the spot price. They're novelty items.
Right.
But I see this being operated under the Treasury. It would not be operated under the central bank system. It would be operated within Treasury.
Okay.
Because there's a big difference.
Okay, can you explain the difference between the central bank and the Treasury, please?
Well, central banks hate gold and silver. They hate it because they're in the business of manufacturing paper money. Why would they encourage the use of a competition that would put them out of business in creating this fractional reserve where they make all their money? It makes the rich very, very rich by being able to print pieces of paper and force everyone to use them, you know?
Yeah.
So central banks hate it, you know? But on the other hand, they want loads of it in their bank when the system collapses because it's a means to them to refloat, you know? But they certainly, the central banks would never be in agreement with it because it puts them out of business. They have a monopoly on the creation of paper money that makes everybody poor. Why would they give it up? That's why it would have to be under Treasury. You couldn't trust them.
And how do you trust the Treasury?
Well, the Treasury would have to be audited by different auditors, not the same auditors, 2 and 3 times a year. And whatever they're left, if people deposit their gold or silver with the Treasury, it would have to be audited to make sure it's there and that no fractional reserve, lending took place on that. And people could, if they didn't want to get around, get a debit card. So in other words, in the post office, if they didn't want to carry their coins around, they could put them on deposit with the post office. And the post office gives them instead of a credit card, they have a debit card, and they can use that debit card to go around and shop with it.
And as their coin is on deposit, it's actually increasing in value all the time as well.
Exactly. If people didn't want to carry it around, that's how I would see it actually working. But you would have to have an organisation thoroughly checked, thoroughly audited, and absolutely within the audit of the people. You could not have a situation where you had put it into a commercial bank. you cannot trust them. They have proved they're not trustworthy.
Absolutely.
So you'd have to be very careful about it.
Absolutely. So you're talking about having everything nationalised, and how about even having the nationalised banks and then the nationalised post office accounts also monitored locally as well?
There's no reason why. I actually see this going global, because people will demand a better system than they have, you know. But because I understand the consequences of for people, and I watched firsthand when I lived in Africa, people dying of starvation, and I now know why that happens.
Can you talk a bit about that, Clare, about your experience in Africa, how you got there, and what you saw there?
I'm determined to do everything I can to bring the corruption to an end, you know.
Yeah. Can you talk a bit about that, Clare, about the experience that you had there in Africa? Why did you go to Africa?
The first water treatment plant, my children were very small at the time, and my husband worked for a company at the time that built the first water treatment plant in Tanzania. It was about,
I
learned more there in 2 years than I learned in the rest of my life.
Wow.
About humanity and the lack of humanity and corruption and just appalling. I want to do everything I can to make sure that I try and put a stop to what's going on, because it's worse now. It's actually worse now than it was then.
Okay.
You know, when you stop to think about what's going on just in Egypt alone, most people in Egypt spend 80% of their week's wages, 80% of their week's wages just buying bread, nothing else.
Wow.
And the reason for that is it's priced internationally in dollars. And because they're mass producing the paper dollar to such an extent that the purchasing power is zero, by Christmas, I'd say most Egyptians will be spending 100% of their week's wages just on bread. You're going to see mass starvation throughout the world. I just try not to think about it too much. I just try and focus on trying to save the Irish people. And in saving the Irish people, if I can bring the Spaniards and bring the Italians, I know I can cut the rug from under these guys. I know. This is their weakness, you see. I know their weakness. The weakness is when they can no longer mass produce those bits of paper. I know their weakness, and I'm determined.
Okay. I appreciate that as well. I appreciate your point of view there. Now, we have to look at the point of view of the globalist agenda that's there. We can't ignore this, because it does seem to be very much playing out right now, and we're on the threat of another world war in the Middle East, where they're moving against Syria right now. What they're doing is they're providing funds and ammunition and weapons of all sorts to the Syrian rebels. This has actually been actively promoted on the national news over in America, and they're also obviously looking to go into Iran as well. It's going to be very, very costly. When this happens, the price, the value of the dollar is going to plummet even more, Clare. What's your thoughts on that?
Things are changing. Things are changing. Russia and China have stood up to the Americans, and the Americans now know that there's a line drawn in the sand. It's a very subtle one, and people have stopped using the dollar to trade in. You know, they say you can't have a global reserve currency unless you back it up with a gunboat.
Yeah.
You know, but things are changing. Things are changing. I'm not sure about the war thing in Iran, but of course, the war for Iran is actually being conducted in Syria.
Yeah,
you know, that's actually the battleground for Iran. It has nothing to do with Syria. That's the battleground for Iran.
Yeah,
it's taking place. That's where. But we won't talk about it too much, because but things are changing. You know, things are changing. It's a question. Will the change come quick enough to put a stop to people's gallop, you know?
Well, apparently that the Bretton Woods Agreement back in 1941 is now up. And
sorry?
The Bretton Woods Agreement is now up, but the Americans no longer have the right anymore. I think it was a 60-year agreement, and it's up now, so they don't have the right anymore to have the reserve currency that is up for a review, and that the reserve currency should shift to another country, or a new plan should emerge for the world.
Well, I think a new global currency is in the middle of, it's being formed right now, and I see that as being, China is buying gold like there's no tomorrow. Yes. They are buying up every bit of physical gold they can get their hands on, because they want to be, the next reserve currency of the world will be gold-backed.
Yeah.
I've no doubt about that at all. The Chinese want to be part of that. They've, for quite a number of years now, they don't export any gold. They buy up everything that they can get their hands on. The central banks have bought 40%. They've increased their purchasing by 40% in the last 12 months alone. I personally think that the next basket of global reserve currency will be perhaps one-third Chinese, one-third the dollar, and what's really going on in Europe, but it's too big a discussion for now, is they're trying to accumulate the gold that's in independent hands within Europe to get it in under the ECB, so that the euro will be part of that global reserve currency. But that's another conversation maybe for another day.
Yeah.
But that's actually what's going on. That's why they're trying to collapse the different countries. Spain has a huge hoard of gold. Italy has a huge hoard of gold. And they've already confiscated Greece's gold. It's always in the small print of the Troika agreement that they confiscate their gold. That's what this is all about. I think the new global reserve currency will be made up of, if the Europeans succeed in bringing down Spain, bringing down Italy, and they put in the small print that they seize their gold, you'll see the euro being launched as part of a global reserve currency. That is really what's going on. That's the agenda. As far as I'm concerned, that's the agenda. But it's going to do the citizens no favours at all. That's why we need to work together as citizens. Mm-hmm. You know, it's we the people of every country, you know.
Yes, absolutely, absolutely. Well, Clare, it's been great talking to you. Is there anything else you'd like to discuss before we wrap up the interview?
James, I'm really sorry, but you're cracking up there.
Yeah, I'm definitely cracking up, that's for sure. is there anything else you'd like to discuss before we wrap up the interview?
I don't think so, but what I'd like to see here, I'd like to say is, if anyone's listening to this that are worried about what I've just said, I have painted a pretty black scenario. But I actually think Ireland probably is the most important country in the Western world at the moment, because we're small, we can mobilise quickly, and we're really, really, Irish people are really smart. They're really smart. Once they get the information, they cop on very quickly. We have fantastic natural resources, and as a people, we just make a decision as a people that we want change, and we can do it. And we have I travel all over the country, and I look out the window of the train, and I just, it's such a beautiful country, and
sure,
beautiful green fields, and we're blessed. We're blessed in the country we have. We just now have to protect that blessing and to use it for the benefit of everyone. And I don't believe the way the left are going about it. While I sympathise with what they're trying to achieve, I think they're going about it the wrong way, you know?
Yeah. How do you propose that we change things?
Is this going to help anyone, you know?
How do you propose that we change things, Clare?
I'd actually like to work with the left, you know, to say, right, this is what's happening. People are getting poorer and poorer by the day, but demanding more wages isn't the answer. The answer is to get a stable monetary system,
yeah,
where people's purchasing power of their hard-earned money will go up instead of down. That's the answer, mm-hmm. Not Robert Peter Pay Paul. Somebody said the problem with socialism is that sooner or later you run out of other people's money, you know?
Yeah.
So let's get a money that's worth something. Let's get currency that's worth something, you know?
And there's also then there's the issue of the gold, the oil and the gas that has been licensed out under a different regime in this country, under the Fianna Fáil regime, that was criminal. And there's a huge amount of wealth just there.
The bailout of the banks is illegal under international law. Yeah. It's illegal under odious debt. It's illegal under the Lisbon Treaty. the signing away of the gas and oil was done by an individual who's been proved to be corrupt in court. In an office, on his own, he renegotiated. It would, you know, all you have to do is contest it in law. But we just need to stand together as a people. Just stand together as a people and say, enough is enough. You know.
Absolutely. Well, that's all we've got time for, Clare. Thanks very much for coming on the show.
Well, it was a pleasure talking to you, James.
We'll have you on
Thank
again
you very,
very soon.
Yeah, please, God. Take care of yourself, James. Thank you.
And that was Clare Leonard from Occupy Dame Street, where Clare was the treasurer for the Occupy Dame Street camp. And I've met Clare many times, and she speaks a lot of sense, I have to say, in many ways. Certain elements of what she's talking about I don't fully understand, but that's all part of the challenge. But what is for sure is that we do need something stable, and as she has mentioned, that gold and silver have been stable for 6,000 years and been used as a currency for 6,000 years. And the questions I put to her was, if the elites control the gold and the silver, then how can you trust it? But she did answer me as best she could, and fair play to Clare for coming on again. Now, she did mention one of the civil servants that retired recently, and that the golden parachute and a large payout and pension. And I'm going to read an article out exactly about this individual who she's talking about. The title is, Politicians Failed to Grasp Financial Risk During Boom, says ex-Mandarin, is on the independent.ie website. Ireland's most powerful civil servant during the boom, Dermot McCarthy, who left office with a golden goodbye of €570,000 and a pension of €142,000 a year, has claimed the government was warned of the financial and economic risks, but politicians failed to fully understand the vulnerabilities. In documents released after a 19-month FOI battle with the Department of Finance, McCarthy admitted in September 2010 that reflecting back Ireland's financial vulnerability and exposure to international money markets was extreme. He said, politicians and civil servants were blinded by success. We were swayed by an abundance of resources, he said. But he insisted risks were certainly highlighted by his own department of the Taoiseach and the Department of Finance to their political masters. Notes from McCarthy's interview for the Wright Commission's report into the Department of Finance's failure show McCarthy said government were advised on financial and economic risks and need for corrective action. Vulnerabilities were not fully understood. McCarthy also defended the social partnership, which via benchmarking allowed Ireland's cost base to spiral out of control. Partnership, he insisted, had not ended, and further engagement was needed between the state and trade unions. He criticised, however, his colleagues in the Department of Finance, saying they need greater depth and breadth. Much sharper analysis and evaluation is needed, McCarthy said. He also expressed concerns that hard-nosed analytical skills may have been lost. The Public Accounts Committee plans to grill McCarthy alongside other civil servants like David Doyle and Kevin Cardiff and former Taoiseach Brian Cowan as part of its investigation into Ireland's economic collapse. And that there ends Awaken Ireland Radio for this week. Thanks very much for listening in. Now, we do have a Facebook page. It's facebook.com/Awaken Ireland Radio. There's also an email address you can write to if you'd like to appear on the show, or if you'd like anyone else to appear on the show. It's awakenirelandradio@gmail.com. And you can also ring in the show live if you wish. It's cloudwarrior1975 is the Skype address if you'd like to call in. Normally during the start of the show we have an opportunity for people to call in and air their views on whatever topics they might be interested in or might be in the headlines of the day. So again, I'd say thank God that there was no false flag attack on the Olympics in London, because that was the biggest fear that I've had now for many weeks, and I can sleep easy tonight knowing it didn't happen, and hopefully that the world can work through its incredible amount of diverse and complicated problems that we face on a regular basis as a collection of nationalities globally. It truly is a global village that we live in today, with the instant communication that we have around the world. I'll keep on doing what I'm doing, and so will everybody else in Awaken Ireland. So from me and everybody else in the Awaken Ireland team, we bid you good night, and we talk to you again next week. The song we're going to finish out on is another Crowded House special. Good night and sleep well.